up, y'all? We're back. Back at it. Five maniacs on the loose. In the fields of timeless movement, we come to you with the knowledge of the ancients. Unfortunately, we also have amnesia of the ancients. Sorry. Welcome. Yes. We're going to play songs. We've got a radio show for you. Welcome to our zoo crew. Yeah, our first song is a little number that Fab chose. And it goes out to all the ladies and the dudes. What was that first song you chose, Fab?
First song is by a woman called Anika. I saw her play it elsewhere, and she was alone on stage. Huh. And she blew my mind. And I've been listening to this song ever since.
It's funny, weird coincidence, because literally today, I shart you not, I texted the managers and added her name to the list of people that we would that'd be cool to play with. We're quints.
That makes me very happy.
Musica. Presentar.
Number 7 of our
on the strokes
top
chart. Cool
strokes chart.
We sharted today, guys. We sharted at number 1.
Top of the charts.
Top of the charts.
You mean number 2. I'm sorry, it was right there. Number three in England, and our streak, pun intended, of inappropriate conversation continues. Okay, I'm done. Bye, guys.
All right, who's next?
You know, it's funny, I was also thinking today, coincidentally, it would be cool if there was some kind of top 10 or top 5 that didn't have to do with, you know, pop charts or, you know, just kind of cool songs of 2020.
Yeah, cool.
Or the month or whatever, you know what I mean? Just some kind of cool chart. Anywho,
yeah.
Maybe we should, one of our next shows, I'm going to promote it now since I'm natural born shameless promoter all of a sudden. We should do a show of, like, you know, 2019 top 10 or something, or current top 10 or something, like new music.
Oh, yeah.
Cool.
Hubbard's like, well, no shit. You're like, are you okay, Albert? You look like you're about to kill yourself. You sound like it.
No, that would be incredible for ratings.
I'll take that as a yes.
What's it called?
Yeah,
like, who cares about songs anymore?
No, I can play music. No, I love songs. Love them.
Songs are great, man.
You lie!
Songs are my favorite. You want me to play a little beginning of them here, or?
I'd prefer it if you just sang it for us a cappella. What was that?
Playing guitar.
Oh, okay. I thought you were like, yeah, fuck you, bro.
Yep. Well, I picked a God of My Voices song called No Sky. I've been listening to this album while building puzzles. So it just, it's my go-to song right now. Let's play it. Under the Bushes, Under the Stars. I just always play. It's four vinyls, and for some reason, side A and B of the first vinyl, I play each side twice, and I just keep doing it. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. I don't know, I can just, it's gets me in a zone.
Cool, man.
It's also known as an OCD's way of listening to records. Gotta listen to both sides twice,
It's not that, it's just that when the one side is done, I really want to hear those songs again. It's just like, oh, it's done. Like, it's a good feeling. And then after two times, I want to switch.
Nikolai.
Yes. Well, I thought with everything going on, I'd lighten the mood up a little bit with some literal videos that I came across on YouTube. And the first one would be Total Eclipse of the Heart. Literal version.
That was my dad's favorite song.
Literal version?
Random use of candles, empty bottles and cloth, and can you see me through this fence? Creepy dollar window and what looks like a bathrobe, then a dimly shot of dangling balls. Close up of some candles and dramatically posing, then stock footage of a moon in the sky. Messing up my close up with a floating blue curtain. Now let's see who's coming in from outside. Why am I reacting in this shot? Wander through a hall with doors that magically open, and this classroom has a fan.
Open chairs.
Now it's getting creepy, you can tell by my staring. It's a long time since I've been with a man.
Stupid chair.
Emo kid is throwing slow move dub in my face. I guess that means that he just flipped me the bird. Staring at the swim team gets you killed by a gang of dancing ninja men who know how to twirl.
Spin.
Then a bunch of preppies make a
drinking
toast.
Drinking wine, douchebag.
Most of it just ends up on the floor. And they shoot in fans tonight. Or they gonna hurt the gymnast. Why do they play football inside? Here's another shot of fencing. And I'm all sleeping there from behind. Watching shadows run off. I'm lifting my arms. There's nothing else to shoot. So zoom camera under this arch.
And there you have it.
Wow, that was fucking hilarious.
Yeah,
although it makes me wonder, what the fuck is that video about anyway? What is that?
We can go to see a show, but I'll make you pay.
What the fuck is
that? Nikolai, you're doing this.
Are you sharing this with us on purpose?
Just stop sharing.
Control the situation. What the fuck?
Phoenix likes his Weird Al, yeah.
Phoenix is like, yeah, Dad, I like my Weird Al.
Blaming it on Phoenix, but
Phoenix was throwing it,
why did it take over your computer?
Way to throw him under the bus, man.
What?
Way to throw him under the bus.
Okay, it wasn't Phoenix. It was my tabs. So, yeah, it continued playing.
You have much honor.
Jules, you got a song for us?
Yeah, you know what I was thinking? I mean, I just got too many sometimes. I was thinking there's a band, maybe I could almost do a whole show on it, really. And I know it's like a famous band, but kind of feel similar that I felt about Queen for a long time, where it's like one of those bands that you know, but they just have so many actually great songs. And, you know, obviously the movie came out, Bohemian Rhapsody, and it weirdly chose the perfect, like, most, maybe except for one or two Queen songs that maybe it missed or I disagree with. It really, like, was a great compilation. And also just the way they did the music in that movie was incredible. But I think the band is Thin Lizzy. And I just feel like they have so many cool songs that are not that famous. Like, everyone just knows the boys are back in town, and that's, I mean, whatever, fine. But I would say they're probably 10th best song or something, if you even would put it in the top 10. I mean, it's their hit, whatever. But anyway, a lot of Thin Lizzy songs that I love. Here's one. Still in Love with You. Y'all know that one?
I don't find something else to see it through.
Question, because I had a two-parter. One was about the Queen thing. I also thought the live performances were amazing in that movie. But besides that, you'd said there's two songs missing, and then Thin Lizzy, you said you had 10 songs. Is it from a bunch of records, or just?
It's like, just over time, I just kind of stumbled upon.
Right, but is there like an album that began the stumble?
No, just Shazamming.
Yeah, I always like
Shazamming mainly. I Shazam these random songs that I thought were so cool.
And it's always Thin Lizzy.
It's always Thin Lizzy. Yeah, so what were you saying? What songs do I think they left off of the Queen thing?
Yeah.
I thought, like when the movie ended, because it was the main one that stood out to me was Breakthrough, and I thought they were going to play that one at the end credits, because it has like a kind of Bohemian Rhapsody intro.
When they play at the end, I Want to Break Free.
I can't remember.
To break free. It's funny you're talking about Queen, because my mom texted me today, the weirdest text from her saying, is it a guitar? Okay, so she said, on the song Bijou by Queen, is it a guitar? And I don't know the song, and I listened to it, and sure enough, it is some beautiful Brian May guitar. It's like an instrumental song. I think that's off their last record. Is their last record the 1991 record? Probably, right?
Yeah,
this
record's called Innuendo.
Yeah, Innuendo. Yeah, that's what it's called.
Well, actually, if you're talking about Queen, have you guys ever heard that?
Oh, yeah, Breakthrough is off. Okay, yeah, I see. Sorry, go on.
Have you ever heard the early version of Under Pressure? The demo of Under Pressure?
Yeah, that's dope. That's really fun to hear.
So good, man.
Let's play it out.
It's called
that Freaky Deeks right there.
Wow, that's cool. That looks like they're on the chat with us.
Oh wow,
Hello, Brian.
That would be funny to do that.
Play the demo.
We're playing that dope demo you guys did in
Yeah, we need to do a Strokes photo like that where all our heads are on one thing.
The demo for Under Pressure, right?
No, it had a different name. It was like even before the demo. It was before
demo.
It was before David Bowie did anything. It was like the guitarist just brought in the part. And
it was like before they wrote it. Before they wrote it, it was still an idea in their heads. Have you heard it at that time?
No, there's no bass line. The bass line is not the bass line. It's like, it's a really cool.
Sounds exactly like the finished song.
I know, what the hell?
This is not the demo, I don't think.
They said that that was the demo.
That's kind of like in the.
Oh, is it called Feel Like, maybe?
Yes. Yes.
That's go, go, go. Yes.
Thank you.
hearing that makes me want to go to the studio though. It's so cool.
It's what it reminds me of us like just messing around. And apparently the story is that they were going to do a collaboration, David Bowie and Queen, and David Bowie didn't like the song that they were doing. He wanted to scratch it, and he was like, do you guys have anything else? And they pulled out the demo, and then they started working on that. And then they each, Freddie Mercury and David Bowie, each went in a separate room to work on lyrics. They were like competing on writing the best lyrics separately, and then they would go into the studio and like record that, and it was a very coke fueled night apparently and Under Pressure was that's how it was written.
But the song doesn't have a lot of structure. It's like just one guy gives a hook, the other guy gives another hook, and then they're just like competing with each other like for vocal hooks.
Yeah.
There's no chorus, there's never a thing that repeats.
Yeah.
No, that song always gives
me... Yeah, they ended on bad terms, though, right? I don't know why. It always seems like Freddie Mercury and David Bowie, it was like tension, right? Even in the movie, it was like all they gave that song was like doom, 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 doom.
Yeah. And it was Vanilla Ice's version.
No, did you ever hear him talk about... How he didn't rip it off?
Oh, Lord.
Nope, but here it comes.
Ding 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 diggy ding ding. Ding 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 diggy ding ding. Ding ding ding. That's the way theirs goes. Ours goes ding 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 diggy ding ding. Ding 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 diggy ding ding. That little bitty change. It's not the same.
Next song, boys.
You know the Thin Lizzy song, Whiskey in a Jar?
Yeah, that's a great one.
was watching a cool Bob Marley interview the other day. Did you guys want to watch?
Is that the 25 minute one?
Yeah.
yeah, it was really cool.
Is 25 minutes too long for you to enjoy Bob Marley, dude?
Not me, no.
You know, I was thinking about Bob Marley the other day, too. I realized something. It's almost like you have to be, to fully appreciate him. I don't want to sound stupid, but it's almost like, I don't know, you have to be kind of with it politically to like fully appreciate. It's almost like a, what do you call it? Litmus test? How do you spell it? What's that word?
That's the word.
Litmus.
Of like, I don't want to say like being woke, but it's like you have to kind of understand imperialism to appreciate Bob Marley to the fullest, I feel like. Anyway.
Yeah, but that's the beauty of his music too, and the simplicity of it and the welcomeness of it, is that even if you're, for those people who are not on that level, there's something so appealing about his music and his vibe and what he created that kind of pulls you in and can serve as someone's introduction to that stuff. I hope maybe that's the optimist in me hoping for that.
Maybe. I mean, it seems like that's not fully appreciating him, if it's like just the weed thing or just the I'm just here for the good times, no political stuff.
Yeah.
I feel like when you dive into the full thing, his lyrics are so much more powerful. Just like that first record, you know, Catch a Fire, and like the lyrics, Concrete Jungle and all that, like coming out like that, it's like the first, I mean, I guess, yeah, it's like for hip hop. I don't know, it's pretty, I wonder if it was influential on, anyway. Yeah, big fan. You know that show Like It Is? It's like a good morning, it's like a Sunday morning, but kind of, it's like kind of a black morning show.
Yeah.
It's still on, I believe, or at least was a few years ago. I don't really watch network television anymore, but yeah, so it was that, I'm assuming, you know, it's like a Sunday morning episode. So yeah, it's cool to watch it like that, with unedited, basically.
Let's watch it.
Pleased to have you as a guest on Like It Is.
Thank you.
How did it all start? Had music always been a part of your life from when you were a little boy?
Yeah, you know, growing up, musical family, grandfather, mother, uncle, sister, Pitney, everything.
What part of Jamaica?
St. Anne's, you know.
Yeah?
That's in the country.
What town?
A town called Rodnall. It's not well known, you know. It's a little place up in the hills, you know.
Yeah. How big is your family?
Well, my family is really big family, you know. Malcolm, the family name is Malcolm. There's plenty.
That's a good name.
Yeah.
When did you begin to get involved in music, really?
About 1958.
Doing what?
Well, we're always interested in music, but that time I was learning trade, you know, and meet up some guys who can sing. One named Desmond Decker. And so we started out from kind of rehearse together and thing, you know. And then one day we went away, do some recording. Then I fell after.
Mm-hmm. You weren't doing the same kind of things then that you're doing now. What kind of music was it in the beginning?
That music was ska.
Ska?
Ska music, yeah.
Well, how does ska different from reggae?
Ska is different in sound, different in style, different playing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Ska is a more quicker music, mm-hmm, than reggae.
No relation?
Yeah, it's almost the same music breakdown, but much slower, you know.
Uh-huh. Same root?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
It's almost the same music, ska, But honestly now, if it was playing at 33, it started playing at 7.5, you know,
I hear
a bit more.
That's a good analogy. How does reggae and ska come out of calypso? Many people ask that.
Yeah, because the calypso was always there first.
Right.
You know? And then now, when the musicians in Jamaica started to play, although them can play calypso too, because they play a lot of calypso, but because the American influence music come past through down there, you know, them start to kind of get more to, them time used to have Fats Domino.
Yes.
And plenty of them type of people. So after a while now, the music start drift from the reggae. It used to be a music almost like a half blues. It used to play before the ska start, you know. Even people like Joe Higgs, cha-na-na, cha-na-na-na-na, cha-na-na, cha-na-na-na, you know that music?
Right.
Used to play that plenty.
Uh-huh.
So from there now it developed to people start ching, 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 ching for ska, you know. And then for rocksteady is like jeng, jeng, jeng. For reggae now is check, 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 you know. So you have three different feel. But the three of them can put together again and make one thing still.
Now, calypso music, most of it dealt with family and folk stories and love and beautiful island in the sun, things
See,
like that. How did it move into what we're getting in the music now, where we have message?
Because during that time of this calypso and thing, people never wasn't so conscious about Africa and where them roots come from.
Mm.
Since reggae come now, people get, I mean, not from a point of music, because music is always conscious, but since the reggae come now, the reggae start talk about Africa, blackness, you know, in a militant way. So that is how it kind of, that is how the lyrics differ from the Island in the Sun.
Well, who are some of your influences?
Well, I think my biggest influence is Marcus Garvey and Selassie. Sure.
From what you heard coming up as a boy about Garvey, or what you've learned now that you're grown, or what?
What you hear, what you read, you know, and what you know about him.
Did you learn much about Garvey in school?
No. Yeah. Yes, them don't teach. It's the education that we don't get in school, you know. We don't get that type of education that when we grow up we can know who we is.
Mm-hmm.
We get a more education that we might know who Christopher Columbus is, how Marco Polo is, you know. But we never really know who Marcus Garvey is, who Haile Selassie is, how any black man is.
Were you born as a Rasta? How did that evolve?
Well, we figure now I was born, you know, and when born and growing, there was a certain amount of consciousness in myself, that, you know, it was always a lonely world, not finding people who might think like me, you know.
Not
to say that I think so different, but because of this consciousness about God and the people I'm come from is more Christian, you know. We always try to do, like, try to stand up on the right. But we used to find out now that one church quarreling against the next church, and I figure I never want any of that, you know. I never want really enter into the thing where this one will fight against that one and everybody talking about God still. So after going on and coming up, you know, the thing that was there get more stronger, come to Kingston, meet some more people, them people is Rasta. You talk to them and find out it's the same thing I have inside. It's the same thing.
How old were you when this started to happen?
This is about 17, 18, you know.
Uh-huh.
I find out that's the same thing where I deal with, the same thing where the Rasta man talk about. So that is how I could identify myself as a Rasta. By not changing, you know.
Now, what happened when you went back home and told your family what you had found?
Oh, I never have a home to go back to.
No?
No. Where we from, everybody gone, you know?
Uh-huh.
Everybody gone. Everybody living in America, some living in Kingston, everybody gone. So, never really have a home, not that much, although we used to have a home before grandfather died, you know? But after grandfather died, everything gets crashed. So,
you know, so you came to Kingston, and that's where it began to happen.
Yeah.
Where did you live in Kingston? What part?
East. I'll call it East Kingston.
Mm-hmm.
Out near the east. Yeah. And then we go up a place named Oxford Street, you know, down to Spanish Town Road, down to then up to Trenchtown.
Yes. So for a long time, things were kind of lean.
Well, yes, things was kind of lean as can. It leave to what is your expectation anyhow, though, you know? To me, it was lean, but I could understand it because coming from a country where you learn to do things like you don't learn to depend on family and all of that, you know? You go out and you plant your own corn and you watch the corn grow. When corn grow, you pick your own corn, you know what I mean?
Yes.
All of them fruits on them tree, you can get them, you know? So.
It's a little different, though, in town.
Yeah.
You know, you got to do different things to eat, eh?
Well, when you're in a city, it's a whole different ball game, you know?
Right.
People have to go to work, catch the bus. You know, the country, all the day, you go for the donkey, and you ride the donkey to the farm, and you're cool, you know?
Right.
You know, the city, people hustle, catch the bus, go to work, get off of work, come back home, you know? So it was a different thing up there.
I know a little bit about Jamaica, and I understand in Kingston, Trenchtown is a rough part of town. How did you survive?
Well, while living in Trenchtown, you know, as a young man, surviving was easy. The only thing you'd have to really look out for was the police, you know. Because the police could have just get you, frame you, you go to prison, and because you come from Trenchtown, you know, Trenchtown's up. From them say, where you from? It's a Trenchtown. You're gone. You know what I mean? You get shipped out.
How do you handle fame?
I handle fame by not being famous.
Come on, you know you're a famous man.
No, I mean, you know, not to me.
No?
Not famous to me.
Some people get drunk off of fame.
See, I learned from he was coming in, from I just started music. You know, the people them want me. Them sure me say, hey, this game is a game where if you don't mind sharp, you lose your consciousness. So the only way you can lose your consciousness is because if your figure say you're getting, some people say rare, your head might get swell.
Right.
And if your head swell, that's it. So, you know, really don't keep my head in a bandage that it can't swell. True.
How do you handle the women that come at you in droves? People have visions of women beating down the door to get at Bob Marley and grabbing clothes. Is it like that?
No.
No?
No, money is, you know.
Is it difficult, though, to keep your balance and not, you know, get to feeling that you're more important than you really are when so many people are after you all the time for different things?
No, you see, I don't think, I never really check myself, you know. I know I am benefit to the people, you know. That's the only consciousness I have of myself, that I can be beneficial to a people. You know? And we don't know anything else. We don't know that.
What do you think it is that has made Bob Marley such a big name?
I think, you know, maybe it's just what Bob Marley stand for.
What is that?
The truth. And the determination to stay alive and survive. You know?
You have a record out called Survival.
Yeah. That was last year.
Yeah. Was anything, did anything happen to you that caused you to write that?
Well, 1976, I'm shoot off of me, right?
Yes.
And I figured that was survival, you know?
Yeah. What happened when you were shot? You were in your home.
Yeah.
Was it in the morning or at night or what happened?
Well, it was about, that's about 9 o'clock in the night.
Yeah.
What happened is that the night before, about 3 nights before that, I was living at a place called Bulby, you know? Mm. And I went to about 3 o'clock in the morning and get some sleep. And then I vision I was in a lot of gunshot, you know? That was a dream. I was in a barrage, a gunshot, and but when it all over, you know, it's like me never really getting a shot. But me see my mother get shot. You know, the vision show my mother get shot in her head. And what happened is like the vision said, don't run. You know, it's like during all of this gunshot, it's like something that the vision said, don't run. Stand up. So when the gunshot started firing on Hope Road, the first thing come back to my mind was the vision. And all I could remember is that the vision said, don't run. And so me have to stand up, you know. And, you know, them fire until it was a tired fire, and then two is not really a lawful gun battle. Man starts to run and it ease up, you know.
And that where was. Were you hit?
Eh?
Where were you hit?
Me? Yes, sir.
Yeah. Went right through? Or just skin?
No, them said lodge inside there.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You never saw the gunman?
Well, at that time, no.
But you know who did it?
Yeah, I know them.
Were they caught?
No, but I don't caught the police. Mm. Just, you know, one of them.
You have a record company now?
Yeah.
Why?
Oh, you know, a long time we always have a record company. What we have now is a recording studio. When we go into the studio to work, it was a lot of hassle. I mean, we're a rasta, you know? Some people don't want a rasta in them studio. No, if we stop all of this, you have to make one, because, you know what I mean? A man might say, don't you say, I'll slash your God? Well, you know what I mean? Go and build your own studio. You know what I mean? So, all right, I'll slash his God and we'll go and build a studio, you know? So, you know what I mean? And I said, go. Them things come through sabotage and through pressure. If everything was nice, maybe we wouldn't have to build a studio. But, you know, it's just a tricky place. It's not everyone really have that humanitarian feeling. Some people just deal with, them don't even know what I'm dealing with. Mm.
What's ahead for Bob Marley, do you know? Do you have an agenda or a master plan?
Well, I feel ahead for I and I is the unity of Africa. And then when the unity of Africa come, then people will really understand, say, you know, there was something in this thing. There is something in it.
Do you think of yourself more as an African than a Jamaican?
Yeah. Because one of the main things is that we're Rasta. From you accept Rasta, you become an Ethiopian, which is Africa. Next thing again, the history of Jamaica shows that the Arawak Indian was living there, and it belonged to the Arawak Indian. Now, our history shows that through slave business, black people come out of the Western thing, you know? So we still figure, say, Africa is a root, you know, and this is where we must return to.
What do you see as most of Africa's problems as far as uniting? I mean,
I see Africa's problem is that outside people keep on fatiguing the people, you know, and make them can't really get them things together, you know. If it's not this superpower, it's that superpower. But Africa is only a place which part of music exploit, you know. Nobody know really. Africa so rich that it become a man just going to Africa, steal out what he wants, steal and carry back in a free country. And Africa stayed alike, you know. But Africa ready.
Garvey used to say Africa for the Africans. Is that how you feel?
Yeah, Africa for Africans, a woman abroad, you know. True.
Will your home base, though, always be Jamaica? Or someday would you like to live in Africa?
No, someday going to be in Africa.
Yeah.
Maybe we open a Jerusalem, you know what I mean? Let them Bible land.
And what do you think lies ahead for Jamaica?
I think what lies ahead for Jamaica is that Jamaica is a beautiful island. The best thing Jamaica could have been. It's just like how Jamaica, like how England owned Jamaica. Jamaica must make some part of Africa own Jamaica. You know what I mean? And it work more nicer, I mean, you know. But if it's going to be a thing which part, we always have going to have a war. Because the only solution is either them get themselves with Nigeria or with someone, you know what I mean? But make Jamaica become some African, something to do with Africa. That's Africa, who in Jamaica, you know? But because the people and them whole ideology and philosophy where they want to come with, you know, some people want to be Marxists, some want to be this, some want to be that. And nobody don't, and plenty of people don't want to be with them is. And where them is African. And Africa have its own culture, and its own people. And, you know, all it needs is people who keep it down for either die out of the earth or something.
What is your feeling about the condition of black people here in the United States?
I feel like black people should develop themselves, you know, not to settle down, just developing up yourself, having a prejudice thing to it. It's just that we are people with our own history and culture, we can educate ourselves. I mean, we are the first creators. So we have really, everything we see on this earth here, is a black man make it. And I'm saying that the white man don't make some, but all wisdom come from the black man.
You know, a lot of young viewers look up to you and are going to want to hang on every word and every syllable. Do you have a message for young people?
Well, you know, the whole thing again is to really check out the truth of Rasta and don't make like fallyism. Don't make you check it out. And don't get too busy that you can't check out the truth. Because the truth is there. And Africa awaits its creators. And we know that the people in the West, headwise, it's them ready, you know? Them have to learn, come learn. What them learn in the West, them have to carry it home to them people, make it be a benefit to the people. Because I mean, how long must the black people suffer? And these are people, you know? And then we have our own culture. We have everything. We don't shatter anything. We have everything. Plus, we have a land that no one is living there. And we must go home to it. And when you go home, you can build all of these big buildings if you want. I mean, if you miss a city, build a city. You know what I mean? If you want a car, you can get a car. I mean, I don't see the big thing. One time America was, you know what I mean, maybe used to have lots of all what I call it, all sort of thing I walk through. Africa is a peaceful place. Then we want to fool black people, but it's a jungle and blah, blah, boom, boom.
Where have you been in Africa besides Ethiopia?
Zimbabwe.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Gabon.
How did Zimbabwe strike you?
Well, you know, Zimbabwe nice, man. Zimbabwe really nice. I mean, you know, it's like a paradise in a place. You know, when you go in and see it. Beautiful.
How did the people react to you?
People's great. Yeah. People good. You know, them places when you go and you see how the people and how the land set up, you see people living. You see a man having a mouse and a nice piece. And then the whole thing about it, the climate, you can go out all the while. You know what I mean? The climate nice outside. Yeah. If you want to look upon a few lions and things, you can walk and go. And if you want to see some things that man never make, but it look like somebody make it, that's all Zimbabwe too. Because I go in a place and I see some stone farm. Well, I know it's not no man make it, but the weight farm, you know, is higher than something.
It's really been a pleasant and informative experience talking to you, Brother Marley.
Nice.
I thank you for your time.
I agree.
Wish you well.
There's a cool Bob Marley song called Trouble on the Road Ahead. Have you guys ever heard it? I have it queued up if you guys want to just hear 2 seconds of it.
Yeah, please. Yeah. I was typing it in to look at it.
Tone. I love the sound and the feel of it. It's,
we should use that tone for the fake. I sent it to you guys. The
Old Lang Syne.
Thank you. I've been playing it.
What did you send to us?
Old Lang Syne.
In the Dropbox folder.
What's that studio called?
Flux.
You didn't send that. That's much cooler. You just sent us.
I think I vaguely. Is this when we were covering the New Year's thing? And then we would, at rehearsal, we would sometimes, as a joke, break out into reggae?
Yeah.
That's where this came from?
Yeah, I sent it. I sent you guys a couple of the reggae takes.
I did not receive this stuff, but I got to check the.
You did. You wrote back. You were like, these are cool.
Yeah, it was when we were in Berlin.
Oh, and then I put everything
a while back. Okay, got it. I gotta go. I gotta go back. You're taking me back.
You guys want to talk about Bernie or no?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you guys sad?
Yeah.
Totally sad about Bernie.
Disappointed.
more.
You guys aren't psyched about Biden? Are you guys going to vote for Biden?
Of course.
Voting for Trump, man. Come on. I'm sorry. Let me backtrack. That was a fucking joke for anyone who might think I'm being serious. Sorry, Nicola. You think I'm being serious. I'll vote for whoever is running against Trump. I just wish Joe Biden was like fucking like broadcasting every day, like the Joe Biden podcast happening every day and talking about the things that he would be doing. If he were the president, what would he be doing different from Donald Trump? And he's like, for some reason, he's not saying much at all. And this is his chance right now when all the shit is hitting the fan. Show us that you can lead. Show us what you would do. Show us why we should, show us why, I don't know, man. I don't know what to say. I'm starting to, it starts to make me angry, so.
You guys want to see an animal video?
Hell yeah, here it comes.
Are they apes or monkeys?
Nikolai, what's the difference between an ape and a monkey?
I don't know, actually.
What if I told you a monkey is an ape?
I wouldn't believe it. I'm just kidding.
One of the five categories of great apes, the bonobo, the silverback gorilla,
Now, there's a second orangutan at the end, and he just reminded me of, like, he looks like he's playing the bass. I don't, it just struck me as, that's funny, because he's just kind of, like, standing there, like... Very,
it looks like the orangutan is playing the bass in this video.
You're talking about the fake one.
The one you showed me, the one you sent.
Yeah, but one of them is like a fake one. That freaky one.
Oh, that was fake? Oh, I didn't know that. He looks like just like very still and it's just kind of like...
Yeah, it's a robot.
Oh, I didn't know that. I had no idea. It looks so weird. I was like, what the hell is that? That's and then it makes the other one like competitive. To, like, she wants to like.
Can we watch that right now, please?
Yeah.
The robot is so freaky.
So freaky. That's why I was like, it just seemed very unnatural what he was doing. Wow, I had no idea that was a fucking animatronic.
That's a robot?
No. One at the end.
Despite being totally wild,
so louder.
She is watching.
This is not a robot. This is a real thing.
Like us, orangutans have an opposable thumb that allows them to grasp and handle objects with precision. Over 20 years ago, a rescue orangutan learned how to saw by watching people constructing the huts here. But this is a totally different and wild orangutan. She seems to take pride in her work, even clearing away the sawdust. She's so smart, she uses her feet as a vise to steady the branch. Filming a wild-born and free-living orangutan mastering this complex task is remarkable. But now, she's not the only orangutan sawing. Spy orangutan has joined her. It seems to be bringing out a competitive streak. She's becoming even more enthusiastic.
Good though. I mean,
it's like there's an amazing one. I'll send you guys if you're interested. Of like they think a monkey has died, and like they're all like mourning it, and it's pretty amazing. But you can probably find it. but it's like the whole village, like the way they care about a child. Like if a child dies, they get, it kind of freaks you out because you realize that emotionally we probably are
identical.
Pretty cute when she yawns.
Emotionally, the difference between us and them is that we can kind of get anxious and neurotic about our own mortality, and they don't, you know, they're like, oh, someone else died. I don't think apes are conscious of their own sense of dying one day.
Maybe they are. They're probably, well, maybe not of old age, but they're probably anxious of, like, getting, you know, beaten to death by other.
Oh, of course, they have, like, survival instincts like all animals and all creatures, but I think that what separates us from them is this neuroses of anxiety of dying.
It's also their ability to believe in myths.
No, we have that ability too.
No, they don't. No, they don't have that ability.
Oh, they don't have the ability to believe in myths?
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, that's an advanced, yeah.
That's like sapiens. What I found really interesting about that book also is they can't conceive that like whales exist in the water. Like they don't know that other animals exist in different parts of the world. I think that's, you know, I thought that was funny.
Yeah. Mm.
Sorry, I feel like I kill it every time. Like my last sentence is like the end of the segment.
Oh man, you make us think, man. You make us think.
You drop the mic every time.
Yeah, that book's
this spaghetti. I'm sorry to cut this shit short, but now my family's texting me and they're like, yo, what's up with this spaghetti?
Spaghetti ending.
I think spaghetti ending is pretty good.
Thank you for joining. Join us again one day.
Thank you.
Goodbye.